Good evening, everyone, and welcome to SocialFlight Live. My name's Jeff Simon. We have a fantastic show for you this evening. We have Chris Rose, Senior Photographer of AOPA here, and Scott Slocum is back with us, President of Aero Marketing Group and Photographer for EAA as well. And as we go to get started, I'd like to open up a little another part of our presentation here for you to see. Another quick reminder, you know, we have a very interesting perspective on things here at SocialFlight. We get to see people who are actually out there flying, going to events, what are happening at local chapters, destinations, all sorts of activity. It gives us a very, very unique perspective during this crisis at how general aviation is doing. And so I'd just like to say that we are seeing some outstanding growth over the last month. August was absolutely amazing, and September is already in its first half showing to be absolutely booming as well. And so I would encourage you very much to go to socialflight.com or get the free SocialFlight mobile apps. It's just SocialFlight, one word, and you can see the tens of thousands of events and destinations and everything else that's happening. I think it's very, very important that as long as that we're all practicing safe social distancing, which so many of the EAA chapters and other organizations are doing right now and still able to have their events, we can keep our industry going. We can support the small businesses that make us up and the FBOs, the pilot shops, everything that goes to keeping general aviation going. That's really why we created SocialFlight to begin with. And it's really helpful for all of us, for our community. Another piece of news here, we had the release last evening of the first chapter of SocialFlight's Summer Adventure of 2020, and that was our glacier flying in a beach bonanza. Part one, Into the Storm, has been released, part one of our journey, and you'll have to watch to see the details of that, but we had a really epic trip and something that I think that I'm hopeful that all of you will be able to join us with as well. So tonight, we are here to talk about aviation photography and specifically air-to-air photography. And I'd like to introduce Chris Rose of AOPA. Chris began his career, let me bring Chris on the line here. Chris began his career in aviation in 1993 and has traveled extensively throughout the Americas, Europe, Africa, photographing aviation-related subjects and events. His work appears monthly in AOPA Pilot and AOPA Flight Training magazines and has been published in periodicals and advertising around the world. Chris resides with his family in Frederick, Maryland, home to AOPA headquarters. Chris, how are you doing?
Jeff, I'm doing great. How are you?
Good. I somehow don't actually have your monitor right up in front of me, but I'll find a way to solve that in a minute. I'd like to then also introduce who will be joining Chris tonight, and that is Scott Slocum. Scott is president of the Aero Marketing Group and photographer for EAA. Scott's love of aviation and warbirds goes back to attending CAF air shows when he was young, watching B-17s and Mustangs take to the skies of Harling, Texas. Scott has been a professional aviation photographer for over 15 years. He has over 100 magazine covers to date. He's been shooting for EA since 2015. He's a native Texan, lives in Dallas with his wife, Catherine, and daughter, Taylor. How are you doing, Scott? Let's bring Scott on the line here as well.
There we go. I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on, Jeff.
Excellent. Now, quick note to everybody else who's watching here, as far as controls of the system, two things. First of all, you actually can go and post your questions in the Q&A section of the software that we use here. We'll try to integrate the answers to those questions directly in our program, and we will also try to see if we can answer some of those towards the end if we haven't gotten to them. If we do run out of time, we'll pass those along to both Scott and Chris as well. Another quick notice, tonight's broadcast will be recorded. And if so, for any reason, anyone would like to see something afterwards, a link will be sent out to you and you can always find it at SocialFlight's YouTube channel. And lastly, while we are showing images, which we will be showing tonight as part of this broadcast, that you have the ability, if you're looking on a mobile device, you can swipe the screen left and right, I believe, or up and down, and that will make it possible for you to actually go and see different parts that are different things that are going on there, whether it be us on screen or whether it be the images that we are showing, and you can resize things as well. So with that, let's get started. Let me start. First of all, Scott, you created that quick intro video. You've got to give me some background. That was, we're here to talk photography, but that video was absolutely spectacular.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. So we were up doing a project in Minot, North Dakota with these two Mustangs. The one, the D just got finished, and they're doing a story for EAA on that. And that's actually a compilation of some B-roll footage that we got from our camera system we have on our Baron, and that we put together. So I kind of liked it because it kind of shows, you'd probably agree, Chris, I mean, it kind of shows what air-to-air is all about, right?
It's just absolutely.
Movie. Yeah, yeah. So
maybe your air-to-air, my video doesn't look that good. I think that was amazing. Really
well,
beautiful.
Thank you. I appreciate that. So, but anyway, yeah, it's, I mean, those two great pilots flying those airplanes, it was a real pleasure to capture them.
What was the story behind it? How did that video shoot happen?
Well, so again, doing the story on, there's two airplanes, Lopes Hope, which was restored a couple of years ago, and then Miss Kitty was just restored this year. And so we went up to do a shoot with them both together because they're both in the same livery, the Blacktails. And so we brought them up to shoot stills. That was the main mission, but I went ahead and set up the video system on the Baron while we were doing that, to, since it was so beautiful, just go ahead and get some nice footage of the aircraft as well. So wow. Yeah,
well, we're obviously here to talk about stills, so let's first talk about, I mean, Chris, you're new to the show, how did you get involved in aviation photography, and how did you wind up at AOPA?
Well, I didn't start out as an aviation photographer for AOPA. I actually, my degree is in graphic design with a minor in photography, and I started at AOPA while I was still a senior in college. So I started in 1993. I commuted from my dorm room to AOPA for the first couple of months that I worked there, but got hired as a graphic designer and later the art director. And then transitioned over to photography, I think probably about 2006, 2007, something like that.
Wow, and that must be, fascinating. I mean, between the two of you, when we each get our monthly magazines, a lot of those epic pictures that we see and those air-to-air shots are done by the two of you in EA Sport Aviation and AOPA Pilot.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's not a lot of aviation photographers out there. There's a lot of people that take pictures of airplanes, and some very good photographers also do some aviation photography. But for people like Scott and I think that we're sort of a unique breed because, you know, our specialty is aviation, and that's pretty much all we do.
So let me ask you, Scott, what's involved when you approach a shoot? There's a lot of moving parts, I would imagine, to this.
Absolutely.
Take me through how it goes from concept all the way, through some, what are the stages that are involved there?
Yeah, so I tell my students that the shooting is actually the easy part, right? So it's the logistics of organizing the shoot. You've got the pilots are the most important part of it. Your photo pilot is very key. The pilots of the subject aircraft, they need to be formation. They need to have some formation experience. If they don't, you need to know that so that you can work around it. And then you got to understand the compatibility of the photo ship with the subject aircraft. You know, if you're in a Bonanza shooting, for example, a jet, you know, what are the envelopes, the flight envelopes, so that you can make sure everything can stay safe for what you're trying to accomplish creatively. And then your locations, what is the client looking for, or the editor of the magazine, what are they looking for, and then weather. So yes, there's a lot of things that need to come together to make a shoot like this happen, starting with the organization of it. So Chris, what do you think?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I mean, the organization is key, and just making sure that everybody is, you know, aware of what the expectations are and making sure that everyone, like as you mentioned, is a qualified formation pilot and cool. that they actually are and not just saying that they are.
Right. Well, I'm gonna bring up one of the images here, and I'll tab through some of these as we move along, and that will allow you to see. And again, for everybody watching, you should be able to see our webcams, and then be able to swipe back and forth if you'd like to see some of these images or size it back and forth. So this is obviously one of them. I think Chris, this is one of your shots. Was this for a story? Or was this for Embraer?
Yeah. So this was for a story that we did for our turbine edition of Pilot Magazine. We shot that on the coast of Florida, down near Melbourne, which is Embraer's home base, and that is I believe that's a Phenom 100.
Yeah.
We shot that a few years ago. It was just a beautiful evening and. Wasn't a lot going on in the airspace, and so we had the sky to ourselves. It was a great shoot, and great pilots. I mean, I've worked with a lot of formation pilots, including our own, which are some of the best, as I'm sure EAAs are. But from a corporate standpoint, I have not worked with too many other pilots that are more savvy at formation flying than the corporate pilots at Embraer. They are really, really good.
And I mean, and Scott, this is a good one for you. Do you guys end up often working with the same pilot? I would imagine at least that you may be working with the same pilot for your aircraft and different pilots for the target, for the one that you're shooting. Is that the case?
For me, yeah. I have about four different guys I work with that that fly my airplanes that I trust explicitly. And know what I want, because that's another key aspect of this. To make it one of these shoots go really well, the photo pilot needs to understand the creative aspect of it also, to help find the backgrounds and get the lighting in the right way. And so, yeah, I have a couple that I go to for certain kinds of projects, like one guy specifically for video, because he understands how to move the airplane around to get the video shots I'm looking for. But it is key, and I think it's a very underestimated part of this process is the photo pilot on this, as far as their experience level and to be able to execute great creative and do it safely and in a timely manner.
I agree.
And so do you both, I mean, what type of aircraft do you generally shoot out of when you're doing this? I know you learned from Scott, at least from the great Paul Bowen shooting out of, he used to shoot out of the back of a bomber, right?
Right.
I think all of us would shoot out of one of those if we could, but.
Right. But yeah, he operates two 58 Barons. We had an A36 that we just sold, but both of those platforms are great. You know, obviously if you could shoot out of a B-25, it'd be probably the most optimal platform out there, but. It's a lot more expensive and harder to work with. So I think what, Chris, you guys use A36s, right?
Yeah, we use mostly the A36. Obviously we're shooting some slower aircraft because some of the subject aircraft are a little bit smaller. So we try to obviously, match the aircraft as well as we can. The A36 gives us a really broad platform to, we can shoot everything from jets actually. This particular photo that you have up right now was shot with the Bonanza. That was actually shot with Patty Wagstaff's V-tail Bonanza that has photo windows on each side. But AOPA has two Bonanzas that we use, A36s that we can remove the doors on. And then we have a couple other aircraft that are available to us if we need them. We've got an Air Cam. We've got a 182 with photo windows and a few others.
Now this is another one. Is this the Waco on floats?
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of a rare bird. There's don't see too many Wacos on floats these days.
No.
Yeah.
That was
shot right over Frederick, Maryland, actually, not too far from AOPA's home base.
Oh wow, that's pretty impressive. That's a fun one. Now I know Scott. I'll switch over some of the shots that we have. from you here are many of the military. Let me see if I can get that brought up here. There we go.
Oh, okay. So for EAA,
a lot of coordination right there.
Right. So EAA hires me to do what they call their fast moving stuff or more complicated formation stuff normally. This is obviously a heritage flight to the F-35 flight team with the Kavanaugh's P-51 Mustang. And the challenge on this shot, just real quickly, the F-35 does not look good flying slow. It carries a lot of alpha. And so in order to make it look kind of like it wants to fly in formation with even a Mustang, you need to position the airplane a little bit different angles for them to go together. And I see a lot of photos of these of mixed matches here, and the F-35 doesn't look as good with it, but I like those. We brought the airplane up a little bit, and I think it worked well with the Mustang here on that.
And that's kind of based on like the angles that you're showing. And when you say alpha, you're talking about, of course, the angle of attack that the aircraft's flying at. And you can kind of, you can see that in the wingtips basically coming off.
That's screen. Right. Exactly.
That must have been a great sound.
It was.
That's a lot of noise happening up there.
Yeah.
I have to ask both of you, because we have one of the questions that came in that's really seems like, you know, it's on everyone's mind. How do you secure yourself in there? How are you able to be safe at the same time as you move around as much as you need to for the shot?
Just hold on really. No, we use approved harnesses that are affixed to a hard point inside the aircraft. Yeah. And then all of my gear is also harnessed in. I actually use these like coiled, it's basically, it looks like a telephone cord, but it's got a cable that runs through it. So all of my equipment, all my gyros, my lenses, my cameras and everything are all secured inside the aircraft also, including myself.
Really? So an individual lens, it isn't going to wind up in someone's backyard ever. That every single
no. Well, I don't have any wood near me right now, but I will knock on it soon. I have not lost any cameras outside of the airplane. I've lost a few lens caps, several gloves, and a couple of polarizing filters. But that's been the bulk of it.
That's been about Scott. How are you for keeping all your equipment?
Same thing. Everything's tethered. What's nice about the A36 and the 58 is the approval to take the doors off is very simple. And there's several hard points that you can attach to on that. So we move around. We can go shoot through the floor, to the right and the left. So we have some movement, but the idea is not to let you go out the door. That's what the harness is there for.
Yeah. Now, did you say you have a port to shoot through the floor?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
That's a poor man's B-25 mod on the Baron there.
That's pretty impressive.
Nice.
Yeah, we'll have to show people that at some point in the future here. Now, Scott, this is another one of your shots.
Yeah, so this is a B-17 out of Oregon that was just painted in this livery. And, my inspiration comes a lot from aviation art. And that's what I have a lot of it hanging in my office. Mm-hmm. And so anytime I see a shot coming together like this with clouds in particular, we all love clouds, right, Chris? I mean, just
they make absolutely shots,
right. I just kind of have in the back of my mind, you know, how would Stokes handle this, or Blair, or Shaw? You know, I just that's kind of how I like to portray warbirds, very timeless backgrounds, and then just to really draw your attention to the airplane. And so I do a lot of corporate shooting as well. It's not like this, but I mean, for warbirds, I love to do this kind of style. So
let's talk about setting up a shot. You mentioned that you brief the mission with the pilot. What are you looking for? Where do you want the sun to be? What time of day? Can you each give me some input on this?
Chris?
Well, you know, traditionally the thought has been, you know, that magic hour, you know, an hour after sunrise and an hour before sunset. And that does yield a lot of great photos. We try to extend that a little bit. I've actually taken some photos that I really liked in the middle of the day. But typically you're looking for a lower angle of light so you get that nice keyed light on the aircraft, and you don't get the, you know, a lot of the highlights and things like that blown out. But typically, you know, a couple hours after sunrise, maybe an hour after sunrise and a couple hours before sunset. It also depends on the time of the year. You know, you get a different quality of light in August than you do in, you know, March or April. You know, you almost have to play it. You have to tailor, you know, how you're going to shoot an aircraft with each individual shot and during different times of the year.
Mm-hmm. So to kind of add to that, if you think about the lower light, you're getting more shadows on the ground. Every mm-hmm. blade of grass is casting a shadow in low light. So basically it's creating contrast. And for me, and like I mentioned before, contrast is what it's all about. I'm trying to find the light in the dark to, so that the attention is really drawn to the aircraft. And so that's why I think shooting in the lower light's important. And I like to shoot, especially business aircraft, even after sunset, you know, where you get that nice reflection of color on the fuselage. But time of day, I think, is important. I mean, you can always put a polarizer filter on to help you out with contrast if you are stuck shooting in the middle of the day. A lot of times that happens, you know, if we're doing military stuff and they only fly at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, so you got to make it work. So Right. Put your polarizer filter on and do the best you can with it.
Yeah, I agree. Polarizers are key.
Yeah.
Now, when we think about, you both mentioned shooting out of Beechcraft, and most of the shots seem to be at this type of an angle. And so therefore, does that mean that the sun should pretty much always be, you know, directly to the, you know, right in front of them or to the left of the pilot, basically always trying to be 10, 11 o'clock sun for the pilot?
No, actually, I prefer the sun to be at about a 1 o'clock position on the aircraft. You know, I think a lot of people assume that you want the sun lighting the side of the aircraft that you're shooting. But that's not always the case. I actually like to position the light at about a 1 o'clock position. That way it really accentuates the natural lines of the aircraft, and you're not getting as much reflection back towards, you know, back onto the aircraft. Mm-hmm. I also find that a lot of times, you know, if I position the sun at 1 o'clock and I've got the aircraft in between myself and the sun, that the sun actually will bounce off of the aircraft that I'm in and help light the sort of the shadowed side of the aircraft. Doesn't always work, but it does sometimes. And so we use that to our advantage also. But rarely do we shoot the sunny side of the aircraft. It's especially with really reflective surfaces, it's tough.
You know, it's interesting. I think you can see what you're describing here. And now, Scott, this is one of your images here of Doc. But I think you can kind of tell that where the sun's coming from by the way it's lighting up the nose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in particular, I'm right with you, Chris, about 12:30 to 1 o'clock, because especially when you're shooting props, it helps light up the props better too, because of the angle of the props. You know, if you can have clouds to help you reflect back, so you can use them almost like a light reflector. Right. And in this case, with this airplane, which was, this was just when it was finished, it was so shiny. If I had the sun right on it, it would be just a glaring mass of starburst coming at me, you know, so much chrome or polished aluminum, excuse me, on that thing. So.
Yeah, I mean, as it is, the wing is reflected all the way up the left side of the fuselage.
That's right.
Polished aluminum looks great until it works against you, and then it's your worst enemy.
Right. It only looks good.
Props, you know, that's always something that people are interested in, has to do with prop blur. We talked a little bit about that last time. What can you tell me now about what you do to try to get that to kind of full disc? And then also, as you've done in this shot, sometimes from our last discussion, you don't always want a full disc. You kind of want to see how many blades there are. So can you tell a little bit about that, Scott?
Yeah, just briefly, when you're shooting warbirds, you know, the amount of blades that you're working with And, you know, I've from experience realized in order to get a full disc on, for example, a radial engine like this with four blades, you're going to be between 1/150th and a 60th of a second, basically about a half a second on that. But this was a more dynamic move. She was breaking away here, so I sped it up just a little bit. So it's not quite full disc, but yeah, you know, the thing was is you used to use gyros to get these kind of shots, but now the lenses are so good at stabilization. I don't really use gyros anymore at all on my stills. So what I'm telling you is that your average really good lens that you would get, you can get something like this. It takes a little bit of practice to be able to how you hold the camera. You know, I view it like I'm shooting a gun. You know, I don't fire and hold it down. I'm shooting. I'm shooting a lot of pictures to get a sharp one. There's probably one out of three of these. Shooting that slow is going to be totally sharp, but you can get it. And it's just a matter of practice.
So do you remember, like for this example, for this particular picture, can you give our viewers an idea, like what was your equipment?
Well, this was the 70-200 on the Nikon D850. And I imagine this was probably at a 60th. We were shooting out of our Bonanza for this shot. We were pretty high. We had to go up to about 11,000 feet to get above this layer. And the sun was setting. I had about 5 minutes with her. And I'm pretty sure that was probably probably around F8 at a 60th. Pretty low light, actually, here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what is that in for ASA?
Oh, I keep the ASA, probably was probably around 150 or so here. The Nikon, you can go to, it's got a pretty wide range of settings here, but whenever you shoot shutter priority, which is when you're shooting propeller aircraft, because you want to kind of lock in what you're looking for there and be able to adjust the shutter fairly quickly, then you, in order not to go too hot or too cold, you use your ISO to keep your f-stop in line. So the sharpest point of a lens, right? If you're shooting at f/22, for example, it's not as sharp. Okay. So if you want to keep it around 8, or you want to go shallow depth of field to blur the background out, then you can use your ISO to control that because your shutter is fixed. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so. I think that makes sense. At least to an amateur like myself, it certainly does. So let me switch again the images that we're kind of showing here and go back here to another one. It looks like a skyline and a totally different kind of angle. Chris, this is one of your shots.
Right.
Really interesting perspective and very much a landscape shot. What's the story behind this one?
Yeah, so we were fortunate enough to travel with a group of folks down into the Bahamas. It was a group of people who owned AirCams. Those of you that aren't familiar with AirCams, you know, it's a great platform for a photo platform, but we followed the group down there. We brought down AOPA's 182, which is the one you see here. It's got photo windows in it. And we just switched positions one night coming back from a photo shoot. It was a low sun angle. And, you know, we were kind of shooting into the sun because we were heading back to where we were staying. We didn't really have a choice, but, you know, we snapped off a couple of shots and it just, you know, the sun was at the right position that it didn't completely blow out the side. And, you know, we were able to still get some light coming in from the other direction. So, yeah, it's one of my favorite shots also.
So what aircraft are you shooting from?
I'm actually shooting from an air cam. I'm shooting from the subject plane. I'd been shooting the air cam that I was in all day, and then we landed and we decided to switch positions, honestly, just because I enjoyed being in the air cam. It's a really fun aircraft to fly in. And we were shooting some shots on the way back, and this was one of them.
I was going to say, I think it's time for AOPA to get an air cam. This is one of the shots that you're not going to get from any other kind of plane. You're hanging out the nose here. Cause I was thinking,
I agree.
This would have been an incredibly fast shot if you were head-on going the other direction from an A-36.
Yes. Yes, this was not the A-36. The air cam's it's a great platform for photography, for most photography. For shots like this, it's unbeatable. When you have to shoot, that sort of that power shot with the airplane coming right at you, it falls off a little bit, but it's a great slow flyer, and it's a lot of fun to fly in.
Yeah. Now this is another one where was this one done?
So that one is on the South Island of New Zealand. We went down there, I guess it was about a year and a half ago. New Zealand is just an amazing, amazing place to photograph. And certainly with an airplane, you can put it into a half a dozen different unique scenarios within an hour and a half photo shoot, because you've got mountains, you've got glaciers, you've got volcanoes, beaches, even desert looking environments. So it was a real, real treat to be able to go down there and photograph these aircraft. And this was, again, we were coming back from a photo shoot, and the light was just right over these mountains. We were able to make these photos.
Now, let's talk a little bit about editing. Scott, last week you talked about a lot of work that's done in Photoshop, and I probably should have opened it since this is Chris's photo with it, but how much of the pictures that we've been seeing are, like, what level of editing is done? This one, Chris, for example, looks, I can't tell, what degree it's real and what degree it isn't.
Right. Well, what's interesting about this photo is, I edit every one of my photos. Every one of my photos, I shoot in the raw format. So I edit and do things like boost saturation, remove dirt and things like that out of the sky that often shows up. This particular photo really doesn't have as much editing as it might look. And it's because the atmosphere down in New Zealand was just, it's almost like being in the West. I actually had to desaturate some of my photos because it just looked unnatural. The sky is so blue. There's almost no humidity. So you just see for miles and miles and miles. So it was another reason to go to New Zealand to photograph. But I edit all of my photos. There's never one that's quote unquote straight out of the camera.
And this one, you mentioned that you actually didn't do a ton on. It looks like it's a Lord of the Rings poster that you just put an airplane on.
Yeah. I mean, we don't replace skies or anything like that. And if we ever do, we always call it a photo illustration, but as far as just a slight, saturation boost, sharpening, removing of, dirt and grime and things like that, they all get it.
It's the same thing with me. I shoot in RAW. You shoot in RAW knowing that you're going to edit from a saturation and a density standpoint. Shooting air to air, there's a lot of dust involved. So a lot of times there will be.
Absolutely.
So you have to get that out of there. But I don't do a ton of, I don't do any background replacement. But it, just like he said, it might be a contrast here, a little bit of color here. Just like he was saying, this was off of Big Sur in California last year. And I had to actually desaturate this one because the airplane was like exploding off the frame there, we did a shoot all the way from Camarillo up to San Francisco, all on the coast. It was a beautiful flight, and
That's a great piece of coastline too.
Oh man, it's just gorgeous. Yeah.
And you have them positioned and framed and put together so beautifully with exactly that moment with the bridge in exactly the right place. It's really impressive.
So that's where the experienced photographer will actually be able to look ahead and see what's coming, and then move the airplanes where they want them. So that you can do this. If they were up a little bit and you covered the bridge, it wouldn't be near as dramatic, right? Or if it was too low and you had to go too wide, everything would look too small. So that's where the experience comes in, to be able to move the airplanes around to fit with the background. And that, as you get better at this, you start looking at the background more than you do the airplanes.
Now, do you fly the route to see the backgrounds first?
No. In fact, I've never even been on this route before, but as you're looking ahead, so on the Baron and the Bonanza, you have a pretty wide open door, so you can look around and see what's coming. And then as the subject gets closer, then you can move them up and down and where you want them to line up for contrast and for the color and for the framing. This particular client was looking for what we call lifestyle aviation photos. So they wanted a lot more background in the shot. So that the idea was that you understood that this is a whole aviation experience here.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I agree. And I think what the point that Scott makes is that, you know, backgrounds 20 or 30 years ago, sort of when I got into the aviation world and started looking at aviation magazines, people really didn't show backgrounds that often in aviation photography. It was all about the power shot. You know, every cover was the airplane right up in your face, the big prop disc, you know, right on the cover, and you really never saw the background. And then, you know, as time has gone on, I think people realize that, you know, you want to see an airplane in its natural environment, and seeing the background really helps capture not only the joy of flight, but really gives you a sense of space and perspective of what it's like to be in the air.
Well, I agree completely. I mean, as a viewer, just as someone who sees these photos, the difference between the close-up or the beauty shot that's just of the aircraft versus like this shot right here, is this is one I can identify with. This is one that like you said, it's like a lifestyle shot. I see it in its own environment. I imagine what it's like then to do it. If I were certainly selling aircraft, you'd want to see this every day versus just how pretty it is on the ground.
Right.
Yeah.
And so to that point, I mean, you had asked a question about you know, briefing and talking about how to set all this stuff up. You know, when you sit down, we do a creative brief and we do a pilot brief. And the creative brief is where the photographer or the art director or both get together and they talk about what they want to accomplish. And then they take that information and the pilots talk about how to execute that safely. So that's our important part. Yeah.
Now, this is a good example of that, Scott. This is one of yours. And now, when you're doing this, are you all on an air-to-air frequency and everybody's on the same thing, including you in the back?
That's correct. So my style is I actually set up to where I can talk to the pilot directly. As the director and the photographer, a lot of people will talk to the photo pilot and the photo pilot will relay it to the subject aircraft. But yeah, we are on a discrete frequency talking here about what we want.
You're on the same way. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, we do it very much the same way. We're on a discrete frequency. I don't have the push to talk in the back like Scott does, but we typically fly with both the pilot and also a safety pilot, and I relay all the messages through the safety pilot if hand signals aren't working.
Got it. And is there a particular story to this one, Scott?
Well, the P-38 is one of my favorite warbirds, and flying next to, in this case, it was an A-36 also at 160 knots. I mean, that propeller is going really, really slow. You can almost count the blades. So I think this is less than a 50th, if I'm not mistaken. But what I liked about it was they had just painted this new livery on this airplane. The night, the lighting, everything just turned out perfectly. It wasn't too bright. I was worried that the colors would actually try to pop too much. No, it just came out great. This was in Massachusetts and over a lake over there close toward this is Collin Foundation's P-38. Oh, yeah.
That's our backwoods here at Social Flight. That's like, we could walk there.
Okay. So yeah, you're here, right? So it was real special for me because just all the conditions, and Chris, I know you probably know this, when it all comes together, it's like this three-dimensional thing that happens. Yeah. Perfect lighting, great pilots, great backgrounds, great subject, and you're creating art. And that's the beauty and fun of this whole thing.
Well, yeah, absolutely. A great shot.
I absolutely love that you also had the contrast of both the lake and the forest.
So that comes that aviation art thing, right? So I want this particular livery was in the Pacific. So I wanted water involved with it. And but I wanted the land to kind of push the aircraft out to sea a little bit from a framing standpoint. And you know, with the trees, it's a little bit complicated. The props got lost a little bit in it, so I waited. I didn't wait. I was shooting the whole time, frankly. But I mean, the shot came in when he when we were in a right hand turn here, and we got over the water. And I think this actual shot was used in National Geographic for spread. So that was kind of cool.
That's it's so impressive, and I love the way that you framed it as like pushing it out to sea for an aircraft that operated in the Pacific.
Yeah.
When you, it's interesting because like I said, I've got students. We teach air to air. But you see it when a student finally realizes they're working with the backgrounds for the airplane versus just shooting the airplane, it's starting to click. That's what aviation air to air is all about, making that happen. Mm-hmm.
This is another example, you know, down of two different planes, but also again, where you went over an island, you could see what was happening.
Yeah, this was Oshkosh a couple of years ago. This K model A26 just got finished with restoration. And so when I'm shooting warbirds, I'm looking for timeless. I'm looking for something that kind of would look kind of like the time frame it would have been in service. In this case, obviously in Vietnam. So it was a hazy morning over a marshy lake. So, and this was actually shot through that porthole in the floor of the Baron. So I'm with this straight down shot. Yeah.
Wow. We're going to have to get a picture of that next. I'm going to start thinking about cutting holes in the bonanza. I like that. Yeah, it really is timeless. Again, it puts you right into that place. I'm going to switch now again and go take a look at when we talk color. Here's one, obviously, Chris, really impressive when we talk color.
Yeah, thanks. This was we did this just a couple of months ago down just outside of I always get these mixed up. It was Beaufort, South Carolina. It's not Beaufort. That's North Carolina. But Beaufort, South Carolina. It's it was this sort of just this marshy area. Just outside of town, really. I mean, if you were to pan up, you would see sort of the downtown and the marina and everything else. But had a great pilot who was flying the subject plane, and just a really cool aircraft. And it was one of these situations, like Scott mentioned, that where everything just came together. You know, we I believe this was an evening shoot, but we got out there. The light was looking great, and it was just getting better. And you know, just the combination of the light, a cool airplane. And somebody that really knew how to fly it for a photographer. So, you know, there just wasn't a position that I could ask him to get into that he couldn't make instantaneously happen. And wow. It was a real treat. That doesn't happen always, but in this case it did. So
now,
and smoke helps. Everybody would be like smoke.
Always helps. How frequently are you flying with people who have had formation training and therefore very much know what they're doing? I think one of the things that's important here is to advise people on what things they can do with people that have had training, and if they haven't, they should get training or keep a safe distance.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I typically, most of the photography that we do is with, you know, the fact that I work for a magazine is nice because the editor that I'm typically traveling with is a formation qualified pilot. So that helps a lot. There are cases when I do have to fly with people who are not formation qualified, but if they are flying the subject aircraft, we will keep them at a distance. We'll keep it a very, very loose shoot. And even when people say, you know, I've flown formation before, that isn't always good enough. I mean, you really want to make sure you want to have sort of somebody backing up somebody else saying, listen, this person's legit. But 9 times out of 10, we travel with our own formation pilot. Or we work with a group of people around the country that we're 100% sure not only are formation qualified, but they're people that are doing this kind of work, you know, at least once a month.
So are you saying that it's your formation pilot often that's in the subject aircraft? Because we understand the lead aircraft, of course, for both of you is all your trusted pilot.
Right. I feel much much better about putting a less than qualified person in the lead aircraft, the actual photo platform. Not that we would ever use anybody that was completely unqualified, but if somebody doesn't have a lot of experience, you know, we would typically put them in the lead aircraft because we've used flight instructors and things like that to fly the photo platform occasionally. But when it comes to the subject aircraft, we almost always use, I can think of only a handful of instances when we haven't used a formation qualified pilot.
Mm.
Because, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, and I know Scott will echo this, you know, safety is job one.
Right.
You know, things can go by the time you realize things are going bad, it's already done. I mean, things right. happen very quickly when you're, you know, 20 feet away from another aircraft, you know, going 150 knots over the ocean. I mean, you don't have the ability to stop and say, hey, maybe we shouldn't do this. You've got to make sure that the people you're working with are 100% qualified.
Yeah. And I mean, obviously, when we're so many of these are of qualified military pilots or people who are part of CAF right. or other things. But I mean, for a lot of the folks in our audience, they're going to be like, hey, what's a great way to go up and take a picture of a friend's plane or get a picture taken of mine? And I think it does make a big difference about what your formation training is for something like that, of course.
Right.
At least one person, either in the subject aircraft or the lead aircraft, somebody in that triangle needs to have proper formation experience.
Correct.
Have two people that are not as forming for disaster. And
yeah. And it has happened before.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. And the again, I think the lead aircraft is way underrated on that. I think that there needs to be more focus on that person with that experience. They're leading the entire formation. Their job is to keep them legal, keep them safe. And so, you know, I've had it happen where I had what I thought was an experienced pilot flying my airplane, but hadn't really done a lot of experience photo flying, and turned right into a four-ship right echelon of Corsairs. And it was like it was a mess. So I mean, just don't take that for granted. I think your photo pilot needs to have some experience and be qualified. And that's my opinion. So
no, that makes a lot of sense. So I think that the message here, of course, is brief the flight, know what you're doing, have experienced pilots along the way, and if not, keep a distance. And
long lenses are for. Yeah.
That's yeah, exactly. Right. So let's talk about that for a minute, because we've got lots of questions again. So Let's start with what a kind of you would each consider, like Scott, tell me a starter setup. You know, what would be the minimum that someone gets out there and wants to start the ability to do some air to air photography?
Well, a DSLR that is able to go a shutter priority at least, and that you have I would say manual control as well, and then the lens, my favorite lens is the 70 to 200. Mm-hmm. And that the lens has some sort of a vibration or some sort of a stabilization mode. I think that's preferable on that. There's so many choices on there, but any, as far as megapixels, don't worry about that right now. I mean, I started a magazine on a 6-megapixel camera. My iPhone's got a lot more than that on it now, right? So, don't worry about that as much as what the camera can do as far as its capability for shutter control and light control. And then the lens, I like the 7200 as far as a good starter lens.
Chris, what about you? What are your thoughts on equipment for someone who looks like they're getting started, wants to get started?
Yeah, you know, I completely agree with Scott. I mean, the 70 to 200, I think, is a great lens. You know, it's a lens that I would recommend to any photographer, for that matter. You know, it doesn't matter whether you're shooting weddings or cars or portraits or whatever else. It is a great lens. It's an expensive lens in most cases, especially if you go with the, you know, the sort of the pro level models, which are typically a fixed 2.8 aperture. But yeah, I mean, it's a great lens. I also use the 24 to 105 a lot. I like it because it is an image stabilized lens, can give me a little bit of a wider angle, especially if the aircraft gets, you know, if we get into a really tight formation, or I want to go really wide just to really show the environment. But, you know, I would say 9 times out of 10, when I go up on a photo shoot, I carry two bodies with me. One body has the 24-105 and the other one has a 70-200.
Fascinating. Scott, I'm going to switch now to change gears a little bit here as we move along in time and get a little closer to the end of our time, to my favorite picture airborne that I've ever seen. How on earth did you get set up to take this picture?
Well, when you work with EAA, they can make a lot of things happen. So, now the XP-82 has just gotten restored, came to AirVenture to be judged, and Doc was there, and we like, that's what this airplane was built for, was to escort the B-29. And so we had to get it together. It got approved. The pilots did a great job. I got video and stills of this, and this is probably one of my more favorite shoots I've ever done. It was just something about it that was very, very special. Tom Riley, who restored the XP-82, I mean, the amount of work and effort he put in to make that happen, the same guy with the B-29. I mean, there's so much story behind this, and the scene in the air together was very, very special on that.
Yeah, that there probably isn't a person in the audience that doesn't want a poster of that one. So I'll talk to you about a signed image afterwards. That's the epic World War II classic aircraft picture if you're ever going to get I mean, people off the street probably see that and go like, how do you Photoshop those two Mustangs together?
Well, that's why I kept the background simple, so I could do that. But yeah. No, I mean, and the other thing about this shot too, you know, I like to work off light with a lot of reflections. And the other thing too is I like, and this, you know, this would have been an high altitude formation. That's what this would have been in wartime. So I moved them up, and obviously you have the smaller aircraft up front so that when you put them together, there's not a lot of empty space. That's important in formation shots here. And now, you know, I'm talking to the pilots of each aircraft, and I'm moving them how I want vertically. So I'll set the lead aircraft where I want it, and then I'll move the second aircraft from there, as an example. I don't know if you can see my hands, but I'm flying.
That's a good point you just raised, obviously, about, you know, distance to the camera, right? Because if you put the XP-82 right next to it over there, you're gonna see a really small XP-82.
That's right. So that's important in formations. And you'll see it, in fact, you'll see over my shoulder there, there's a shot of four Mustangs. So that's an example. I actually used the 70-200 and moved the formation away from me so that the lead aircraft didn't look too large. Because a lot of times they'll fly a formation too close. And so in order to get that aircraft in, all the other ones look too small. So I'll move them away so I can zoom in a little bit to make them more relevant into the picture. That's one of the secrets of shooting formations.
So let me make sure I understand that again. So what you're saying is, if you've got multiple ship formation that you're shooting, you actually want them a little bit further away from you, the lead aircraft to be a little bit further away from you, so that you can properly space them all. Not have one block everything. Is that what I'm hearing?
Not one block and not one dominate the photo. If the shot is about the formation, then I move them further away so I can make them all more similar in size so that the lead aircraft doesn't dominate the photo.
That makes sense a lot. And I think there's probably a lot of number 2, 3s, and 4s out there that appreciate the fact that you didn't make it all about number one.
So the key in doing that is you can't zoom too much, because then you'll have a focus issue or a depth of field issue between the front and the lead aircraft and the back aircraft. Because if you think about it, each one of those wingspans is about 40 feet times four with space in between them. You know, you're talking about a lot of distance there. So you have to do it in such a way to where I will shoot it and I'll crop in a little bit later on, but I still move everything further away.
So how far apart are these two aircraft in this shot?
And these here? Yeah. Are you talking about the XB-82 and the B-29? Yeah. Or are you talking about the Mustangs?
The XB-82 and the B-29.
Okay. And this one, this is 7200, so that B-29 is probably about maybe 75 to 100 feet behind the XB-82.
Okay, so really interesting, and I see the different things from the elements that you've been talking about this evening. You've got you cloud perspective, where you put them to be timeless, the fact that you're thinking high altitude, the distance and how you frame them, and then even sun position, because obviously this is very different sun position than the others.
You know, and we do circles so that we see a variety of light happen in a short amount of time. Right, Chris? Is that kind of what you guys
That's right.
do?
Yes.
Yeah. So I have several other shots in the same formation going around where the props are lit up. This ended up being my favorite, but you're looking. The other thing that I wanted to see is see how the edge of the clouds are lit up. You know, that whole silver lining thing, right? Ooh. So it all kind of came together on that shot and gave it more of a historical effect in my mind. But no, yeah, you've got to be, you brief and you fly the brief, but you don't always shoot the brief. Right. You shoot what opportunities present themselves, and you create those opportunities by looking and adapting to the backgrounds that are presented to you.
Very, very interesting. So we are at the end of our program now, and it's been so fascinating. For each of you, Scott, what kind of parting advice can you give people who are watching? What are your kind of thoughts on someone looking to learn more about air-to-air photography as a parting word?
Yeah, so I really believe that if you can work with professionals, that's the best way to do it. When I got started in this, that's what I did. And that's what I would recommend if you want to do it. I mean, a lot of my students that I work with, they have great careers doing other things, and they want to do this as a hobby, but they want to do it well. And so whether you do it as a hobby or you're trying to do it for a living, work with professionals on it. Mm. Don't just go up with whoever and do this. It's like, would you go cage diving with sharks if you didn't know, right? No, that's the kind of, because this will bite you like a shark will if you don't know.
Once. Yeah. An excellent point. I mean, so much that we do in aviation is all through apprenticeship and all through this concept of learning from mentors and everything like that. And so I guess aviation, air-to-air photography or aviation photography in general is no different.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And Chris, how about you? What are your thoughts on
yeah, yeah, I agree with Scott. I mean, you certainly want to work with professionals. You don't want to go out and wing it because, I mean, there is certainly a degree of danger to this, especially if you don't know what you're doing. I think the aviation environment is filled with people that enjoy taking people up and sharing their experiences and their professions and things like that with other people. I get calls from time to time, you know, with people that want to go along, or I have people come up to me at work or whatever and say, hey, I'd love to come along on a photo shoot. And we try to make that happen. Mm-hmm. We also do some online tutorials and things like that. I know this week on AOPA Live, which is one of AOPA's web-based shows, we're going to have we've done an entire video on behind the scenes of an aviation photo shoot. So, you know, just getting involved, you know, even looking at YouTube and just getting a sense of what you're getting into, and then find a qualified professional and just simply come along, you know, as a flight, going to things like Oshkosh. Hopefully that will happen again very soon. There's a lot of, you know, you'll find people out there like Scott and a lot of others that are willing to share their experience. And I would say, you know, reach out on social media to some photographers and say, listen, you know, I'm having a problem with, you know, this setting on my camera, or, you know, I'd love to meet up with you at Oshkosh and just pick your brain for 5 minutes over a cup of coffee. You know, do that. And you'd be surprised. People, you know, I love talking to other people about aviation photography. It's what I do. It's my passion, just like Scott. And, you know, I have nothing to hide. I will share all of my trade secrets with anybody that asks.
Well, that's fantastic. Again, thank you both so much for taking the time to join us this evening. Chris Rose, Senior Photographer at AOPA. You can reach out to him as well. And of course, again, Scott Slocum, President of Aero Marketing Group, Photographer for EAA. You can follow Scott at Air2Air Adventures with the number 2, air2airadventures.com or aeromediagroup.com. And as Scott mentioned, of course, he teaches as well. And so both of you, thank you so much for joining us on Social Flight Live. I'm sure we could talk for absolutely hours. And I just thank you for the work that you do that shows up through the magazines on all of our doorsteps so regularly.
Thanks, Jeff. Well, I really appreciate being here.
We appreciate
You're
it.
You're both very welcome. For Social Flight, I'm Jeff Simon. Be sure to check in with us again next week at Social Flight Live. We will be joined next week by Four Flight founder Tyson Rise. That's on Tuesday, September 22nd, always at 8 p.m. Eastern time. On the 29th, we have Barry and Brian Schiff joining us. It's going to be a lot of fun. See that father and son duo that are so iconic in general aviation. And on Tuesday, October 6th, Vans Aircraft founder Richard Van Grunsven will be with us. And so, again, fantastic shows coming up. Thank you all so much for such a great program. Be sure to check out socialflight.com and the free mobile apps. That's how you can stay up to date on everything happening in general aviation. We are here to support you. Until next time, I'm Jeff Simon. Blue skies.